H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.
Do you have any questions? Hello? So you guys have any questions?
Hi, Sam.
Yeah.
This is Naga. I tried to use data table to enter accounts, to create accounts. Uh-huh. And for some reason, when I change the number of iterations from 5 to 3 or 1, it's going more than the iterations I've given. I was not able to debug.
It's doing what? It's not doing, or it's doing more than one iteration?
It's doing more than what the input parameters are. I gave three variables, I mean, three rows of data. Then it, when I run the script, it's going beyond that. It adds three and then it's still running.
Best collect, you might have some empty rows in your data table. So please make sure you don't have any empty rows in the data table.
So how do I make sure that there are no additional rows after the data?
So basically, like in the data table, some blank rows are highlighted. So you have to make sure there are no blank rows highlight.
Okay.
Otherwise, the UFT will treat that is also a data. So, but it treats as a blank data.
I'm checking it. I mean, I deleted two rows and saved it. So still, I saw it running. Maybe I'll double check it and we'll run it and see.
So basically, like when you look at here, the data table, right? So whenever you have some data,
mm-hmm.
so it will trade. Like right now, actually, I don't have any data here. Anyway, I have to do parameterization that stuff. So whenever you create this test, so here, this is the data table, and if you put some data here, something, and then later on we delete, right?
Mm-hmm.
Then it's going to treat that as a some kind of data. So something I put here, right? So you see the row is highlighted.
Mm-hmm.
It will treat that as a blank data. So even if you put something here and then you delete later on. But it's going to treat that as a data. You see, these are the two rows highlighted.
Mm-hmm.
So what you have to do is you have to make sure no such rows. Only it should contain the valid data. These are the blank data. So all you have to do is select these rows. What are the things that are highlighted? Right click and then say edit. delete. Okay, so once you do that, so maybe you have to select this one also, edit and delete. So now it's gone.
Okay, and also I tried first to use the action one sheet. I created a header and then I was not able to delete the header. Then I switched to global sheet.
You can delete. So you can delete any data. So all you have to do is right click and then say edit and then delete so that it will go away.
Okay. So, but when I refer in the script global sheet, it should only look at the global sheet, right?
Yes. All right. Any other questions? So you had to do the scripting. So if you associate repository, the UFT is not going to generate the script. So once you associate, then you have to do the scripting part. UFT is not intelligent enough to create the script from repository. So once you associate the repositories, right? So basically you're bringing your test objects to the UFT script. So click on this plus button and you're going to associate whatever the repository, say login of the repository. And then select this action one and click OK. Can you please mute your phones? Please make sure your phones are muted online. We're getting echo. The other people couldn't hear me properly. Still some of the phones are not muted. Please check your phones and they are muted. Otherwise, you people get disturbed. I don't have any issues. Okay, thank you. All right, so here, once you do that, then if you say the script once, then you see the object get exposed in your script. Then, whatever the scripting you want to do from this test object, right? Because these are the test objects that is getting from object repository. So, if you want to do the username, double click on it. So, that is going to generate the script now. Then, the password. Then, click login. It's going to generate the script based on the object what you want to work with. Okay? Basically, all those objects getting exposed in the toolbox. Okay, Solution Explorer you don't have those objects. It's going to just show you what are the repositories that are associated. Can you please mute your phones if you don't have any questions? Suchi, can you please mute your microphone? Alright. Yeah, basically it's going to show you, this one type of the expectation. It's going to show you what are the object repositories that are associated. But only you see the objects from that object repository in this toolbox. Okay. That's where you are going to generate the script. Okay, so Mitali, you are keeping on and off, just post your questions to everybody so that way there will be continuation. All right. Any other questions?
And there are a lot of objects in a repository that we don't use it. Can we just get rid of them?
Maybe you are not using in this particular script. You might use them in a different script. That's why. So just we want to make sure all the objects are available in the object repository. Or you don't use it, maybe some other person might use the same objects in a different script. So that time, instead of creating different object repositories, just we add everything into the object repository and then we're going to use that object repository throughout the project.
Okay. And I think we can rename the object if there are two usernames there. To make it more readable, we can write, we can change the name of the repository, right?
You can change it. Yes, you can change the name here if you want. All right, any other questions? That's good. That's what we decided, right? So first 15 minutes, the QA, then the session 1.5 hours, then the last 15 minutes again on the question and answers. So that's what I'm waiting for, any questions. So you have to make sure, Albert, please post your questions to everybody, guys. So that way the other people should know. And then everybody can better answer that question. So we'll let. So here Albert's question is, I'm not able to add objects to the Word from website. So it all depends what is that version you're using. Okay. The Internet Explorer version, the version 12 don't support. That's the very latest version. You are using version 12, I'm confused. Is it Internet Explorer or VFT? And what is your Internet Explorer version? Just you have to make sure VFT 12 compatible with your into your browser. So go to hp.com and they're going to tell what are the compatible browser versions, right? Because I didn't really experiment with version 12. Still I'm using 11.5. But that's what, as I mentioned, version 12 is very latest version. So it's okay, but you can play with that. But I'm not sure what kind of issues you have on version 12. Whether it's a stable version or it's not that stable, I'm not sure. Okay. But I'm going to experiment with 12 towards the end of the sessions. So you can Google it and then see whether it's compatible, and then or they can provide you some kind of workarounds to work with your browser. All right. All right. So let's quickly recap what we did in the previous class. Anyway, that's first class we did. Just we talked about the VFT, what it is, and what kind of functionality is going to support the GUI level scripting and API level scripting. And 12 is the latest version in the market that they released a couple of weeks back. And also we talked about the features. Yes, we started with the basic features, trying to understand what are the basic features in EFT, and then what you can do with those features. The add-in manager. So we talked about what is add-in manager. So why we need add-in manager? Anybody? What's the importance of add-in manager? And why we need
add-in manager? Gather the object repository.
Identify the object.
Okay. To identify the objects. on the application and the testing. Okay. And then how you identify what is that application you are testing?
You click on the application and it recognizes the objects in it.
I mean, before that, suppose
you have to select a particular, if you want to write like Java and even or whatever the application, what the application is, like Java application or .NET application. So you have to enable those add-ins.
Yeah, my question is like, how you know what is that application you are testing? Is it Java or .NET?
You ask the development.
So you ask the development, right? You're going to talk to the development guys and try to interact with them and try to understand what is the technology they used to develop that application. That's where you learn more about that application and what's that application environment. That's really useful for you to identify what are the add-ins that are required for your application to do the scripting. Okay, that is the very basic step. All right. And then we talked about what are the different views in UFT. Like you will get the keyword view and expert view. Is there any difference between the keyword view and expert view? What's the difference between the keyword and expert view, or editor and keyword view? Sorry. What's the difference between the editor and keyword view?
In editor, you can see the script, and in keyword view, you can, it's for beginners, you can use the keyword view like step wise, you can see what's going on, and it's easy to learn when in the beginning stage with keyword view.
Basically, you can directly do the scripting in the editor, whereas you can always toggle between the keyword view and editor. Editor is basically like something you can directly do the scripting. You can edit the script. This is also kind of expert level. Maybe once you work with UFT, maybe 1 or 2 weeks, then you should be familiar with this editor view. Then you feel more easy to work with editor instead of the keyword view. You can always switch from editor to keyword view here. Toggle between the keyword view and editor. Click on this button. And then it shows this is a keyword view that has different columns, item, operation, value, and documentation. This is much user-friendly compared to the editor view. Right? So you can always toggle between the editor view and keyword view by clicking on this button. So initially, as a beginner, probably you feel more easy to work with this keyword view. So it has different columns like item, operation, and then value, documentation. So what are these different columns in the editor view? What is this item? Item is basically what are the different objects you are interacting with this in the application, right? Item column is going to tell what are the different objects you interacting, your script is interacting with application, the test objects. Operation is what the script is doing on that object.
What method?
Sorry?
Is it what method?
The action. So what the script is doing on the test object. Value is it's nothing but the data that sets into the object. Documentation is it explains or just you can say it's a description. About the line of script. So basically, if you look at here, these are the item is column is the list of the objects, the test objects, what we're doing. Like username is an object, password is an object, and login is an object. Operation is what you're doing on that particular object, right? So username means you're trying to, can you please mute your phones again? Please make sure once you answer the question, please make sure your phone is muted. Still some phones are not muted. Naga, can you please mute your phone?
Okay.
But please make sure because it's going to distract my class. Even the other people are also not able to hear my voice clearly. They're getting some echo. All right. So here, this is the test object, the username. And operation is what you're doing on a particular object. So all those methods or operations available in this list box, right? So you can select what's that operation you want to do on that particular object, right? So by default, if it is a text box, so it's going to say you're trying to set something onto this username text box. And then what's that value you want to set, right? That's nothing but your data. So even if you click on this this small button here, they configure the value, and then you can set, okay, I want to set, say, this is the username. I want to set as into the text box. That way, no, just you can enter, okay, the next one is the password. And then this click. So you're using, because the password is also a text box, you're trying to set some value. What's that value you want to solve? This is CRMS. And then, so you're going to click on that particular button. That's the operation you're using against this login button. And the documentation is going to describe what this line is doing in the script, right? It's going to enter demo CS, sorry, the username that it wants. Or demo enter CRMS in the password that it wants. Or click the login button. So this is the keyword view. These are the four different columns. It's a bit user-friendly compared to the expert view. But both views are same. What are the changes that you do in the keyword view? You see the same changes in the expert view in the editor also. So this is what we make the changes. Then it, you see the same changes in the keyword view and vice versa. Okay. So but if you see here, if you change something here, the username, then you see the same change in the keyword view also. Okay, both the same. Alright, so those are the two views like we learned, and then we started creating object repository. So using this object repository manager, so we created object repositories. So basically you're going to open the application and then you learn all the objects on the login page. Okay, so how you are going to create a shared object repository? So I'm going to create, open this object repository manager. And then you're going to learn all objects, like objects, add objects. Then click anywhere on this page. Sorry. See, like when I'm trying to add objects, so it's giving these options. What might be the problem here? It's not giving the hierarchy like the browser page and tail objects, right? So what's the problem? What you can think of? Because real time, these are the kind of issues like you get into, right? So what you can think of first to overcome this problem? Anybody? This is also kind of entry question she's going to ask. Hey, whenever just you create, you're trying to identify the objects, you're trying to create object repository, but it's not giving like the browser that kind of things, then how you can resolve that issue? What you can think of? What's the first thing you do? Why the... Yes. I got the answer from Suchi. Suchi, can you please post your questions, answers to everybody? So the first thing you have to check, the add-in, right? Maybe you didn't check the right add-in. That's why it's giving this window and win object kind of hierarchy. Okay, so let's check that. So how you're going to check whether you have the right add-in associated to your script or not? Whose phone is that one? Alfred. Alfred, your phone is making some disturbance. Okay, so how we are going to check what are the add-ins that are associated to your script? Go to File and then Settings. How to check the add-in site? Go to File Settings and then this where it's going to show you what are the add-ins that are associated to your script. Because you are creating object repository against this web application, but when you check this add-ins, only ActiveX is associated. So no web add-in is associated. So that is the preliminary check. That is the first check you have to think of whenever you get this kind of problems. So are you getting the right add-in to recognize your application? So in this case, probably like you have to restart your TTP and then make sure so you got the right add-in. Okay, so I'm going to start EFT. And then this time, just want to make sure web add-in should be checked. Okay, click OK. Now, basically, like if you have checked everything, then you can uncheck them. Otherwise, if you don't check, once you open UFT, if you don't check, then it's not going to show up. You have to restart again. All right, so now let's see. So let's create a new GUI test. Okay, now open this object repository manager. So now we're going to add objects. Click anywhere on this page. So I have the web adding. So objects, add objects, then if you do the first time, even though web add-in is associated, still you get that problem. Sometimes what happens is this UFT is a little bit crazy, because I open that application first and then open this UFT later, right? That's where sometimes you get this problem. So it is always, remember, it's a thumb rule. You have to open UFT first and then open the application. If you do vice versa, the UFT may not recognize your application. That's what actually happens sometimes. I went on my system. Okay, you have to open application UFT first and then open the application on top of it. Then you see now, the hierarchy, like the browser page and chat objects. Okay, so these are really real-time issues. Like, okay, we did the same thing. Like, you're under depression. Okay, you're doing the right one. You got the add-in, but that's a silly. Like, why it's not recognizing? Oh my gosh, you did throughout the day. You did this thing, that thing, that. But still, the issue is very simple, when we break our head. So remember always, like, you open UFT first, then you open your application and then create object repositories or record or whatever things you want to do. Okay, so now you got this browser page and the child objects. Select this page in this hierarchy because you want to add all the objects. And then you will get this default object type selected and then click OK. So that's how you create the shared object repository, right? That's what actually we did by following these steps. So once you've got all these objects, then you're going to save this object repository. Just click on File, Save, and then name it. Login, War, New, or something. Then the next step is you're going to associate to this object repository to your test. Go to resources, associate repositories. Then click on this plus button. Select the object repository, the one that we created before. Open. And then you're going to associate your script to this repository. Select action one. Click on this greater than button. you're associating your script with this repository, click OK. So once you do that, then select this action one. You will get select this action one tab. That's where you're going to do the scripting part, right? Then you'll get all those objects exposed in the script. Then you play with these objects, then there's the script. Double click on the objects. And then enter the data. Then how we are going to open application.
System.com.
Let me increase the font size a little bit. Alright, so now we're going to use the one that I'm doing here. This is called the documentation part. Okay. So this is also one of the coding standards, and we're going to learn all these things. But it is always provide the documentation. You put the single code, and then you write. This is like the plain English. Okay. This is the documentation or the commenting. Both the developers and the automation testers has to strictly follow this documentation. Like why we have to do this documentation is the third person is able to understand your script easily once you do the documentation part. Or sometimes you yourself will get confused, right? So you develop your script and then you look at your script maybe next week. You confused, okay, what I'm doing here. Whereas, if you provide this kind of documentation, then it's very easy for you to just understand the script. So you're going to say, open application, and you're going to provide system util. What is system util? Is it an object? Is it a method? System util. SystemUtil is an object. Using SystemUtil object and run is a method. Okay, so we're going to use this SystemUtil object and run method, and here. So, you can mention the first argument. Obviously, the method contains some arguments, right? You see here, the moment you put space, it's going to give you all those options. There are some optional parameters, and there are mandatory arguments. So, you can mention, because it's a web application, the first argument you can mention in which browser you want to open this application, right? If you say iExplorer.exe, then it's going to open this application in Internet Explorer. So if you want to open the same application in Firefox, here instead of iExplorer, you're going to say Firefox.exe or Chrome.exe. That way, no. So you can test the application across different browsers. And then what's a URL? So you can mention this URL. Because this is the application I want to open. anyway. And then, so now you're going to do this login part. Then at the end, you want to close the application. How you can close the application? Again, you can use systemutil. Systemutil.run. Not run. You're going to use close application process by name. That is the method you're going to use. And then here, you're going to mention what is that application process you want to close. Obviously, it is a web application. You have to mention the browser process, which is nothing but iexplore.exe. Okay, so this is again close application using systemutil object, and then this is the method. Okay, so that's actually like you are going to create a shared object repository, and then you can do the scripting part. So most of the scripting will be done this way. So we don't do kind of recording and playback in the projects. Whereas you create the shared object repository, you do the scripting part, and also wherever this is required, you open the application using these methods and objects. Clear? Any questions? Then save this script. Then run this. Okay, so it logs in, and so it's finally is going to close that application process also. All right. Any questions on this? Objects, object repository manager associated also looks okay, but drag and drop, this seems to be a bit confusing. So what's that confusion you have? Can you please elaborate? So what is the difficulty you have, and what's the confusion you have creating scripting from this object repository? Obviously, without knowing the application, there is no scripting, there is no testing. That's the primary step. Okay. All right. Any other questions on this scripting? So this is the result.
Sam?
Yeah.
Yeah, my question is, here we drag and drop the user ID and password and the login. But I'm wondering that if we have more than those objects, how can we identify and how can we drag those in order so we get each and every object sequentially, you know? That's my point.
No, I didn't get you.
So here in this case, we drag the user ID, password, and the click, login, right?
Yes.
What about if we have more than those objects, user ID, password, and login? Even though we understand the application a little bit, but if there are more than these three objects, how can we drag and drop sequentially?
That's what, like your test case is going to say, right? What you're going to do. Either the manual test case or the requirement is going to say, okay, what you want to do on this test case. So you're going to follow the steps and then see how you want to generate the script. But the thing is, say for example, when you log in, because here, like you have, okay, let me turn this. So here, for example, when you log in, right, there are so many fields when you're creating an account. So you don't provide the data from Excel sheet. It's a lot of things. So how you handle this kind of functionality is using the description object. Okay, that part I'm going to discuss later, because you have number of text boxes here. Oh my gosh, am I going to fill all these text boxes with the data? No. What you're going to do is, from your Excel sheet or wherever it is, you're going to mention the account name.
H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.